Can we escape who we are? I think of myself as an artist making drawings. Even when the charcoal is replaced by a spoken word or by an ink word, where we are led by a line, in this case by an ink line, a kind of lapidary thinking and drawing, an embroidery of words and lines, to bring us to some new image, to some new sentence, and then to take this all back. All the potential taken back. All the potential returned into the pen. The barrel of the pen refilled. The pen becoming again a loaded weapon, full of every other thought that is yet to be expressed. But understanding that as each word is said, it cuts off all the possibility of other thoughts. Can a drawing escape where it is going? When it begins, when one is circling the studio, everything is possible. There is a new sheet of paper. All the energy is waiting in one's arm, ready to make the decision. But as it lands, as it gets ready to land, all that potential gets limited, gets coalesced, and it becomes a coffee pot. Launched again, a new sheet of paper, new possibilities. And while the shards are in the air, it's possible for anything to arrive, but what comes? Another coffee pot. There's the question of, can we be better than we are? Can we be other than we are? There's the hope for something new to arrive, that this time there will be something different, but what comes? A typewriter. Trying for something new, and what will happen? Can we stop the reduction of all potentiality? And in the end, we are reduced to making ourselves as a self-portrait as a rhinoceros, a self-portrait as a typewriter, a self-portrait as a coffee pot, a self-portrait as a megaphone. All that we wish we could be. And then there is the Torschluss panic, the fear that with each decision that is made, with the final arrival of the image, all other images are cut out. The door to other possibilities closes behind us, and we turn in panic to the sound of that door. And what would we wish for? I mean, for the shards for once to land as a phrase in the subjunctive in French ultramarine, for a diagram of a galaxy in cobalt violet, for a griffin, for a baby sphinx in one's arms, for a clear line of sight from the history of Greek slavery to the complexities of the political situation we are in now. We'd wish for a painting of peonies by Robert Motherwell in Rose Madder Alizarin, for the design of a new escapement for a watch, for just one unqualified, unguarded declarative certainty. But even as these possible ideas emerge, they become so limited, so small, and the gap between that part of us which feels all that we should be gets larger and larger, and the only safe space is the edge, the margins of the circle.
No, it is. This is the name of the... Welcome. Welcome. No, it is. This is the name of the... What? Welcome. This is the name. It is the name, it. Room one, a beginning. Here we have the seven fragments for Georges Méliès from France. Here we have the, here we have the seven fragments. Georges Méliès from France, from Georges Méliès from, note the, early film. This is the film. This is the screen. These are its screen. Witnesses, note the beginning. Counting frames. Emmett, time. Emmett, time. Have we have the moon? Have we have the studio? Have we have the book flying backwards from France? Have we have the coffee pot? Have we have the ladder? Have we have the charcoal dust? Have we have the toothbrush? Have we have the naked feet on an empty floor? Have we have the big if? Have we have the artist? Have we have the have we have the ant? The artist learns to train an ant. The artist becomes an ant. How to train an ant. Lesson one, calligraphy. Make a supersaturated solution consisting of one part water, two parts sugar. Draw a line from the garden to the studio. Use a number 7 nib and write the word carapace. Use a number 8 nib and write the word crepuscule. Make the upstrokes light, make the downstrokes heavy. Wait. Follow me. Thank you. to the studio room. In this gallery, we encounter many works of varied genres. Many different materials and processes used by the artist are here demonstrated. Tip. Pa-pa-pa. Pa-pa-pa. These are drawings made by the successive Asaksavievim Semyov addition and removal of removal of charcoal marks. Some more shuffle addition and removal of charcoal marks. This is an etching. It records all the damage done to the copper plate. The plate is damaged. Using blunt thorns or sharp nails, instruments, and by acids. The plate is stroked with a rosin feather. We wipe the plate with a rosin buttock. Soft flesh of the palm of our hand. The plate lies on the bed of rosin press under a fat blanket. Charms of white. Sheet. These feet are compact of paper covers it. We press all swell that air swell, all weight onto the blanket. The ink on the plate records that ripe point, parodies the spit bite, the foul bite, close the spit bite, nails the foul bite, coronation. Is the erotics of the studio. The marks on the sheet are our proof. The proof is the logic of the studio. This is some greenish distance, your. This is some panic picnic. Your, tuck, tuck, witty wah wah, tip top, witty wah, tickety tickety, your. Follow me. Morgan Fleur or look at a diabolic or odalisque. Carnation, thorns, nails, cloves. Carnation, thorns. Carnation, thorns, nails. Carnation, thorns, nails, nose. Correction. Carnation, thorn. Carnation, thorn, nail, rose. Correction. Rose. Correction. Correction. Coffee pot. Coffee pot. Behind the shadows. Behind the shadows of the monuments with masks. White faces. Thank you.
History counts its skeleton in round numbers. 1,000. And one remains 1,000. As though that one never existed.
I think first comes the impulse. So for me, the impulse is the impulse to be at work in the studio rather than thinking specifically, this is the image I need to make, this is the message I need to give, this is the story I need to tell the world. It's a kind of a physical, it's in the pectoral muscles, it's in the salivary glands of want, knowing that I need to make something. There's a kind of an inadequacy without making. So that is, for me, that is what comes first. And then you have to find a material in which you can either think or in which you can address this urge, whether it's charcoal or ink or paper. That's in terms of the studio. It's a bit like in one's brain, at the back of the top of the brainstem, we have the periaqueductal gray, which is this tiny little piece of brain, very primitive, but which is the start of consciousness. And it always starts with an emotion, with I like, don't like, need, don't want, too hot, too cold. The things that we need to have to kind of keep ourselves going. And in a way, it's the same thing. It's a very primitive impulse. The want to make something when there isn't something, to be with your hand making. 18, 54, 2 seconds. My daughter was applying for a scholarship, and in the scholarship application, you had to write, what your father does. And she said there was no category to write down artist. And she thought of putting down professional. But then she thought, no. So the category she chose was called semi-skilled manual laborer. Because as she said, well, it's not as if you've got any skills. You can't actually fix a watch. You can't repair the taps when the taps aren't working. And I thought, okay, I'm very happy to be thought of as semi-skilled, but it is about the manual, about the making, about the body involved with the activity, and trusting, if not as much just as the first stroke will show you, but that the physical activity of making is also connected to ways of thinking and allowing ideas to emerge. It's not that if I start with no idea, there's an impulse, there's a first image, there's a reference, there's something like that. But then you have to allow that in the process of making, new ideas will come and things will change. So yes, there is a sense of, I mean, I certainly learned more about drawing from the year I spent at a theater school in Paris than I did from the years at the art school, because it had to do with understanding the impulse behind a gesture, the completion of a gesture, whether it's an acting gesture or a mark on a sheet of paper. The impulse and the results are not so, or the results are different, the one's a performance, the other's a drawing, are not so very different. So yes, the sense of movement. And then of course with animation, whether it's just a jug moving across a table or it's a figure walking, there is a sense of performing that as a kind of actor, whether one does it physically or just with my hand to get the timing. So there is theatre in it. A second thing I would say is from my experience, not so much in theatre, but more in film, where you can construct a set where you say, well, let's, this wall is getting in the way of the camera, let's move that wall out. That light's too high up, it may be right in the ceiling, but it's wrong for the frame. So constructing something for a frame means that all the laws of perspective and ordinary architecture can be thrown out. To get something that looks correct on a screen, you can do great damage to the conventions of what right angles and walls and heights are. So that for me was also a big revelation in structuring drawings at a certain point.
Fums povota ta u pogif qui e o dl r bi b. Dr bibe fumspe. R bibe fumspevo. Bibe fumspevota. Fumspevota tsa. Fumspevota tsa u. Fumspevota tsa u. Pogif qui e. De desen nr ie mpf til tu. Ju. Ka. Rinsekete be be. Insker mu. Zu enze. Rinsker mu, rakete b b, rumpf tilf tu, zu insker mu, zu enze zu rinsker mu, zu enze zu rinsker mu, rakete b b, rakete b b, fums povota za u, o t v t b, fums, rakete, rinsekete. Rakete rinsekete, 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 b b f b v fums b b v r fums b v b v r ta fums b v ta b v r ta ca fums b v ta ca b v r ta ca u fums b v r ta ca u b v r ta ca u p Fims bovetaza u p, bovetaza u pogif. Fims bovetaza u, bovetaza u pogif, qui e. Racketerinsegeta. 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 B, b, f, bover. Fims b, bovera. Fims bever bevibber. Fims bevibber beveribber. Fims bevibber bevetabber. Fims beveretabber beveretatsabber. Fims bevetatsabber beveretatsa uberber. Fims bevetatsa uberber beveretatsa upogif. Fims beveretatsa upogif beveretatsa upogif qui e. Racketerinsekete. 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 Qui è, qui è, qui è, qui è, qui è, qui è. The dozen r ear and puff tilf too. The dozen r, dozen r, 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 ear, mp, mpuff, mpufft, mpuff til, mpuff tilf, mpuff tilf too. The dozen r ear and puff tilf too. The dozen r ear and puff tilf too. The dozen r ear and puff tilf too. Ju, ka. Fums povota za u po gif qui e te desen nere ie in pif tilf tu ju ka rinsekete be be in skermu zu enze zu rinskermu rakete be be. Zekete be be in sker. Rinsekete be be in sker. Rakete be be in sker. Zekete be be in sker. Rakete be be in skermu. Rinsekete bebe inskermu zu enze zu rinskermu. Grim, glim, gnim, bim bim. 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 Lanke tergil, rumpf tilf tu. Lanke tergil, zu len trill. Lumpf tumpf trill. Lanke tergil, pepe pepe pepa, uka, 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 uka. Lanke tergil, pi, 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 zuka, 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 zuka. Lanke tergil, rumpf, 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 lanke tergil. O, b. O, c. O, z, y, x. W V U T S R Q P O N M L K I A H G F E D T B A. Thank you. So, and I suppose so at university somehow someone introduced me to Jarry, and then I became completely interested in him because I suppose I was interested in the political absurd, the political grotesque, which seemed to me a good way of thinking about the political grotesque in South Africa. So even though he's a French schoolboy writing in the 1890s, it felt very close. And the same way reading someone like Ferdinand Oyono, La Vie d'une Boy from Cameroon, which is a novel I read many years ago, and I'm now working with some actors thinking about a theatrical version of it. Again, it caught me. On the one hand, it felt so familiar, relationships of masters and servants, the servants in my white parents' white household, how that worked, and also very different, very specific to a different experience in West Africa. And I mean, there were also South African writers that felt, okay, there's a description of landscape that no one else has done that feels so close to me. So I think that sense of understanding oneself as a bastard made up out of Jarry, Oyono, Shakespeare's sonnet, Nadine Gordimer, different American writers, different moments, and music from all of these different places. It seemed to me, I suppose it didn't seem anything. That's what I was. That's what I was reading. That's what I was interested in. That's what caught me. That's what it's always about. There has to be something in whatever you're reading or seeing that strikes a spark of something that you feel you already know. How did they recognize? How did they know how that felt to be me? And I suppose that's one of the vital parts of that kind of culture, that comfort of knowing somebody else has had that same experience or a similar one.
one that you couldn't name, but which you can kind of recognize. And I mean, also in South Africa, remember, we had the apartheid, which was a very specific kind of identity politics. You were defined by you're black, you're colored, you're Indian, you're Chinese, you're other Asian, as a category was. And so there was an element, a big element of the anti-apartheid struggle was to deny those and to make claim for a kind of, you know, everybody should have a political right, everybody should have agency, which is a kind of universalism. And I understand that there's different new approaches to identity politics to that of the nationalist government, but it was the resistance to identity politics was so built into that, you know, how repugnant the results of it were in South Africa, that I'm still wary of identity politics and of making that the basis of artists. I think, you know, for me, to think of Africa without thinking the way it's been both formed and deformed by the experience of colonialism would be very, very strange. I'm wary of essentialisms, of saying, oh, we must go back to a kind of pre-colonial Africa and think that it could be lived again as if we haven't had that 300 years experience that have changed. I think that one of the reasons that, you know, at one stage when they started with movies, they thought they would be unwatchable. If you did a cut, that you were actually, you saw a room and suddenly there was a person's face in front of you, people would scream and wouldn't be able to read it. And one of the ways, I think, that one of the theories about this is that, in fact, that the way we so easily accept this when we're watching a film, the jump from one thing to another, is that, in fact, we construct our understanding of the world in that same way, of seeing a wide shot, of seeing a close-up, of seeing something very close to us and feeling it very important, of seeing a broader picture, that it's not this seamless world around us that we assume, that we're constantly, as it were, constructing our own film as we go, as we go through it, as we go through the world. And so there is something very close in cinema to how we navigate the world.
Imagine yourself as a typewriter. Lupa mesa bitabi le topa. Yeah, 1, 2, 3, 4. Lupa mesa bitabi le topa. Sepala la suma ota tabu basi.
Take them. You're about to give it to Lani.
Stop.
And you stop, and then you listen to the first one.
Demand which war it is. Not one of our dreams ever came true.
Malibu, be Malibu, Malibu, be Malibu. So there's this notion of point of view is maybe what might allow us in a country like South Africa, but maybe in a country like the United States of America, in many places where people tend to confuse a point of view with a reality. We'll see what happened in the United States. There's an example of democracy.
I think that's a whole question of the what's been happening over many years in Europe and North America, of this kind of reactionary populism. Things that people would have been ashamed to admit before are now openly proclaimed. So that the category of shame kind of disappears out of political discourse. There is no thing that could be done or that he could do that could ever bring the word shame to someone like Trump or Bolsonaro, or most probably even Johnson. Just the whole world is out of joint, but shame is never. And without that, it's very difficult to know how democracy works, if there's not a sense of appropriateness and inappropriateness. When I was 3 years old, I wanted to be an elephant. I failed at that. When I was 15, I wanted to become a conductor of orchestras. But then I was told that to be a conductor, you had to be able to read music. So I was reduced to being an artist.
One of the hard things to realize is the edge of who one is, of what your imagination can produce, of what all the habits of your arm and eye and muscles are. So you start thinking you want to do a picture of the whole universe, but you end up with a coffee pot.
In terms of the training to be an artist, I dropped out of university art school very quickly. It was a very dull course, but went to a private art school that offered no accreditation, the Johannesburg Art Foundation. And it was not a great art school in terms of the formal training, but they brought different poets, they brought other writers, they brought other people who were teaching creative writing. And so what they did at an early stage was make a sense of these are all connected activities. They're about taking an imagination and learning a grammar of making, very hard, either of drawing, the hours and hours of figure drawing or still life drawing, or the hours of writing and then careful reading of poems. And then, of course, the great school, which was the theater school in terms, for me, it was a great school. I'm not an actor, I'm not a mover, I'm not a dancer, but the understanding of the physical and the human body as the starting point for all these artistic activities was vital. I mean, I tried for a while to say, first I was doing everything, all my friends said, no, you've got to focus on one thing, otherwise you'll, now, if you want to draw, just draw. If you want to do theater, just do theater. If you want to do film, just do film. And I tried very hard to do only one, but discovered after some years that I'd failed at that and that they were all happening. And then I understood the only hope for each one was what the the theatre gained from drawing, what the drawing gained from theatre, what the filmmaking got from the music, all of those, not my music, other people's music. And that was a kind of, that was a good lesson. And so where we have the Center for the Less Good Idea in Johannesburg, that's kind of been the basis of it. The energy that comes both from collaboration, but the energy that comes from working outside of one métier, of understanding how a piece of theatre can change what you're drawing, how you draw can become a whole other performance, a whole other
activity. If we become to be an art school professor, what would be the Kentridge method?
The Kentridge, I think I'd be fairly rigorous. I think there'd be quite a set curriculum, in the sense of my arts lessons were all about, just work on the piece of paper and see what happens. And in fact, there are many things you can, many exercises, many specific training exercises you can give people to do, after which they can work in different ways. And so I think a lot of it would be physical activity, a lot of the kind of theater exercises that we did, which are easier to learn because they're in your body and it's a muscle training and that we're more familiar with. And from that, to understand how drawing can expand. If you want to, you know, here are five different techniques for animation, which you need to spend a week doing each. So quite, I could imagine working out a good curriculum over a year. And at the center, we now have an academy there called SO, the Academy of the Less Good Idea, at which we have different short courses and different trainings. And we're gradually working out what would be a shape of a kind of different kind of training, of mentorship, of people learning. It's that's at an early stage, and there are things coming out of rehearsals and some courses we've done which may be interesting. But I mean, I would learn from the other one of bringing people from different fields into to work. I know that when I was at art school, one was able to just spend months on one picture, and what one understood, in fact, in retrospect, that you were drowning. It was not a, it was not gaining in profundity, and so a kind of a speed of work, particularly as a student. There are so many different things to gather that, to allow that energy to grow. You need to grow a critical mass of energy of making, and I think that becomes. That for me would be a central part of school if I was to.
Hence the importance of critical thinking. I have the feeling, and I'm not the kind of guy to say that was better before, but that this notion of critical thinking is getting lost, that people are getting formatted and specialized, maybe times require more cynicism and more arrogance, but that people are working, just go back to this identity politics, that people don't take the time to ask themselves the right questions anymore. Maybe that's why you started your academy with this ironic name of the Less Good.
I think so. Less Good, specifically saying the good idea is the one you write in the proposal, the long essay, but you know when you actually come to rehearse or to make it or to carry out the project, there are all sorts of things in the great idea that won't quite work on the ground, and you're going to rely on things that you find on the way, new thoughts, new insights you hadn't thought of in the first good idea, and it's to create a protection for that way of thinking or understanding or being at ease with that is the way we need to go.
So I'll just ask you, or I want to reflect on one last question, and the theme was what comes first. But for you, what comes next? I'm not talking about the exhibition or the projects, I'm talking about the times we're living. What comes next? What should come next, or what might come next?
I mean, certainly there's a sense of understanding that all the uncertainties and the doubts that we've had in the last year that we've been shown to have, that all the certainties which people thought they had, how fragile they were in the face, in this case, of the pandemic, the way how fragile they are in the face of other calamities, whether natural or social or political, and to go forward with this understanding of provisionality, of uncertainty, of doubt not being false, but being an essential way of making sense of the world.
Do you think we shall remember? Or aren't we going to forget 6 months after we're out of it, waiting for the next catastrophe to appear?
I think it will be both. There's a huge impulse to push on and to try to restore, to restore contact with other people, to going back to things that we liked, whether it's going into the sea in South Africa where the beaches were closed, or going into a bar which has been closed, or going into a theatre or a museum. I think there'll be a huge hunger for that. For some people, they'll have loved the lockdown and being able to be, not have to talk to other people, and will really hate going back to work or being in a crowd of other people. Temperamentally, people will find how they go.
I heard.
I've loved my 9 months, in the studio working, but I would be so happy to be in a cafe somewhere having an easy, relaxed coffee or a drink.
Yeah, I miss cafes too. I'm asked to ask you for a word of wisdom for young people.
Do what you're good at, what you like doing, and in the end, people will respect you for it.
No matter the results.
I think if there's enough impulse and, even if they only result, respect what your activity is, the seriousness of the activity. Obviously, it's nice if they're good results, but as a person, you will be respected for a dedication to something that is close to you and not just an instrumental job.
Well, I've been working in the space, so I haven't yet seen the exhibition, apart from a couple of pieces. But I have a sense of the curator, Carolyn Krito Bakargiev, really trying to find her themes from the work that different artists have done. And so there's a strong correlation between interests of other people in other pavilions and in other exhibition spaces to what we're thinking about in our space. So that feels a good collegiality amongst the artists of the work. The shape of the overall project I haven't seen enough, but it looks very exciting to me.
The exhibition is called Poems I Used to Know, which refers to a state in which certain things used to be certain, but are no longer, like the lines of a poem I knew as a child, but which are gone. So it has to do with indeterminacy and uncertainty.
William Kentridge is one of the most important and significant artists of our time. William comes from a lineage of neo-expressionism, which means he looks at the world and expresses himself through purely subjective means. However, an artist as versatile as William is really beyond categorization.
The exhibition is a mixture of older pieces like I Am Not Me, The Horse Is Not Mine, and a body of connected works. And then there are other works that are connected less directly, the sculpture, the world on its hind legs and the nose, which come out of images that were developed there, a person carrying the world on his back. But take the idea of fragmentation from the fragmentation of collage in the projections, and makes fragmentation the subject of the sculptures, where an image is coherent as an anti-sculpture.
We decided to bring various different works, including tapestries, drawings, etchings, photogravures, sculptures, and video installations. The main piece of the exhibition is a large 8 multi-channel video projection installation called I Am Not Me, The Horse Is Not Mine. And William developed this work for the Sydney Biennale, and since it has shown in major museums around the world, including the Tate Modern, MoMA.
I suppose I always react very strongly against the idea of an artistic statement. That implies that the artist knows something which they are going to impart and hope other people will learn from their work, and putting them in the position of savant or greater knowledge. When the work is always about, for me, trying to work out what it is I'm doing myself. So the process of making the films or the process of making the drawings is also the process of finding out what they are and what they mean. So if there is an artistic statement, it's about an uncertain beginning and an invitation to the viewer to complete the meaning of the work and so to write the statement themselves. Creative process is, there are two stages. The one is the stage before anything happens. The stage of walking around and around the studio, gathering the impulses, different fragments of the world that have come into the studio, until a moment arrives of either clarity or energy, not necessarily clarity, but enough energy to make the first mark, to decide, I'll tear the paper here, I'll do the line that's going to turn into the nose. Process is one of constantly changing between being the artist as someone making a mark, to being the artist as someone who views the mark. I think what I'd hoped when I was showing this work, and why I chose to show this, I'm not me, the horse is not mine, in India, was to see if there was a commonality between South Africa and India. When this work is seen very often in the United States or in Europe, there's a kind of distance attitude to the revolution and the death of utopia that it heralded, which the work is about.
Ich freue mich außerordentlich, dass wir im Museum Haus Konstruktiv nun die erste Einzelausstellung von William Kentridge in der Schweiz zeigen können. Und nicht nur das ist ein First, sondern ebenso das erste Mal zeigen wir einen einzelnen Werkkomplex in einer Ausstellung. Der Titel ist The Nose, die Nase, bezieht sich auf die Oper von Schostakowitsch, die 1930 im Leningrader Mali-Theater uraufgeführt wurde. Und in der Nase geht es darum, dass der Kollegienassessor Kowalow erwacht eines Morgens auf und seine Nase ist nicht mehr da. Er findet stattdessen eine seltsame kahle Stelle im Gesicht. Als William Kentridge 2006 von der Metropolitan Oper in New York die Anfrage erhält, eine Oper zu inszenieren, hat er sich sehr schnell für die Schostakowitsch-Oper entschieden und daraufhin begann er sich zu überlegen, wie kann er jetzt dieses Motiv, die Nase, die sich verselbstständigt, die Nase, die außerhalb des Gesichtes ist, wie kann er die inszenieren, sodass es eine Geschichte, eine Oper, verschiedene Arbeiten, die wir hier in der Ausstellung sehen, dass es das ergibt. Eines der Motive, die häufig zu sehen ist, ist die Nase, die auf einem Pferd reitet. William Kentridge hat sich dabei orientiert an historischen Reiterstatuen. Die historischen Reiterstatuen erhöhen ja den Helden und die Nase, die jetzt verselbstständigt und im höheren Rang ist als ihr ursprünglicher Besitzer, ist natürlich durchaus so etwas wie eine Heldenfigur, eine majestätische Figur. Er schreibt auch davon, His Majesty Comrade the Nose. Und so inszeniert er nun die Nase auf einem Pferd. Und in der Ausstellung sieht man, diese Motivik gestaltet sich eigentlich durch alle Medien. Wir haben Bronzen, wir haben Tapisserien, wir haben diverse Druckgrafiken, wir haben Malereien, wir haben ein großformatiges Pferd aus einzelnen Zeichnungen. Dieses Pferd und die Nase gehören wie so zusammen für ihn. Die Videoinstallation an sich trägt den Titel I am not me, The Horse is Not Mine. Unter diesem Titel entstanden 8 Videoinstallationen, die alle die verschiedensten Aspekte von diesen Fragestellungen von William Kentridge aufgreifen. Beispielsweise hat er historisches Filmmaterial aus den 20er und 30er Jahren verwendet, die ihm Märsche zeigen oder Fahnenträger zeigen oder einen Ausschnitt davon wiedergeben, wie die Leute angehalten worden sind, Stalin zuzuapplaudieren, und weil ihre Hände wehtaten, durften sie sie kühlen in einem Eimer voll Salzwasser. Ebenso sieht man in dieser Videoinstallation sehr schön, wie die Nase als selbstständiges Wesen beispielsweise eine Treppe hochsteigt, aber jedes Mal, wenn sie oben ist, fällt sie eigentlich wieder runter. Also dieses Sisyphushafte, dieses Versuchen, nach oben zu kommen und wieder zu fallen, was man sehr symbolisch auch für die russische Gesellschaft nach der Oktoberrevolution lesen kann.
is a huge impulse to push on and to try to restore what, you know, to restore contact with other people, to going back to things that we liked, whether it's going into the sea in South Africa where the beaches were closed, or going into a bar which has been closed, or going into a theater or a museum. I think there'll be a huge hunger for that. For some people, they'll have loved the lockdown and being able to be, not have to talk to other people, and will really hate going back to work or being in a crowd of other people. And I think temperamentally, people will find how they go.
I heard.
I've loved my 9 months, you know, in the studio working, but I would be so happy to be in a cafe somewhere having a easy, relaxed coffee or a drink.
Yeah, I miss cafes too. I'm asked to ask you for a word of wisdom for young people.
Do what you're good at, what you like doing, and in the end, people will respect you for it.
No matter the results.
I think if there's enough impulse and, yeah, even if they only result, you know, respect what your activity is, the seriousness of the activity. Obviously, it's nice if they're good results, but as a person, you will be respected for a dedication to something that is close to you and not just an instrumental job.